Good evening, friends, and welcome to the fifth Leela Prism lecture in the series Cultures is Continuum. We have with us today Tapan Chakravarti, urban designer, architect, interior designer. Most of you know him, so I don't have to really say anything more about him. And we have Ranjit Mitra here, who will introduce him and his work. I would like to just mention Leela's association with Tapan. How we some 20 years back, more than 20 years back, and this particular publication, he had two have a look at this site. It's www.leelainteractions.in. Every Friday night we publish an interaction, which will be good to look at. So that's how we interacted with Tapan. And when we conceptualized this series, we had no doubt that we should have one lecture by Tapan in the series, because without this, the series wouldn't be complete. That's how this lecture came to be. But more than that, I'm also very happy that Tapan is one person who really understood the spirit of this series as a continuum, because he has attended all the lectures till today. You know, he has every lecture since we started, he has attended very regular, which also means this is also something which we wanted to do with the series, like bring together different people from various fields of knowledge in a horizontal kind of continuum. So Tapan has actually facilitated that by being present in all this, in attending all the lectures, not just come do his lecture and go back, but being part of this whole continuum. So we are extremely happy about that, and we really appreciate your fellowship, Tapan, and thank you for being here. And then Ranjit Mitra, those of you who have attended our lectures would know that we, our speakers choose their chairs, so because we want a rapport here, and you know that the interaction should be meaningful, so the speakers always choose their chairs. So Ranjit's name was suggested, and we requested Ranjit, and he's graciously accepted to be part of this. I don't have to introduce him also, really, because most of you know him. You know, because it's this kind of a space where introductions are done, I'll just tell you a little bit about him. He's presently heading the Department of Urban Design at School of Planning and Architecture. He graduated in architecture from Jadavpur University and in urban design from the same department, School of Planning and Architecture. He serves as a member of various institutional committees like National Design Council, the Archaeological Survey of India, the ICCR, so many committees, editorial boards of significant journals. And not only these kind of academic activities, but he's also designed and executed various urban design projects, architectural projects. So we're very happy and honored that he is here to chair this lecture today. Thank you very much, Ranjit, and welcome to this evening, and I invite you to take this meeting.
Thank you very much, Ali. Just a little word about, I think, Tapan to begin with. Tapan's been a kind of colleague and friend for quite a few years, I think almost ever since I came to Delhi in 1990. And Tapan is the sort of person who has, let's say, is opinionated and has evolved over the years in his opinions. His range of thought and activities is varied. Obviously, you heard that he's presently doing interior design as a major thing, but I think his mind doesn't stop working in the various fields that he has evolved himself. And therefore, the sort of spectrum that he looks at and obviously talks about and sermonizes at times maybe to some people, but it allows a kind of very informed debates on what he does. I'm really eagerly hoping and trying to see, figure out what he's going to say today. We've had a little discussion before this, and it's of general interest to most of us, that because of late, various forms of urban space, public space particularly, has come into perspective for various reasons. And I think, you know, probably one of the reasons why it started was because of these kind of public protests that have happened around the world in various places. It's continuing. Call them flash mobs, call them, you know, other such pictures that have come together, which has been very different from the user space that we've been normally used to. Also in India, that, you know, this, or in many countries, the traditional use of space, urban space, for various purposes, various what they were intended for, how they've transformed themselves, and how they're used today. So it brings in a different spectrum altogether. And it's one area where I think life just keeps on continuing and fashioning itself on the type of lifestyle that we lead, the type of, you know, sort of interpersonal relationships that we have. And starting from protest to meeting to just looking at people, the range is huge. So without much further, we'll ask, I request Tapan to please start the lecture. And after he's finished, then we can hopefully get into very involved discussion. So Tapan, thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Rajita. Good evening, everybody. How do I start? Basically, I'm a teacher, so I'm used to lecturing. Public speaking is basically not my forte. I'll be trying my best. So wherever you will probably find that there will be a lot of that lecturing strain that will be there in the way I'll speak to you, please don't mind. You're not my students. And so that's one thing. Second thing is that I'm not a very learned person. All that I understand, all that I think goes on in the mind on the spot. Generally, whenever I have spoken or made a talk, as one would say, I have written it down so that I don't waver. As a person in the classroom, I waver. Now, I tried. This time I tried that I also write down something, but being a trained urban designer and a teacher, the moment I started writing, it became so unnecessarily profound. Because we as urban designers, we have this urban space as one of our, you know, key subjects or topics. And I remember my urban design thesis had to do with urban space, and there was a big fight in the department when I tried to sort of transgress the definitions of what is known as an urban space, because there is something called urban space and there is something called urban open space, and each one has its own definitions. So the moment I started writing something, it became quite complicated. It was too complicated for even myself to understand. So finally what I did was that I slept off for 1 week, and today morning I thought that ab to sham ko kuch karna hi hai. So I just put some slides together. They may be quite disconnected. They may not be as what you thought it ought to be, but let's go. The first slide, as you can see. A large open space where every human being is a chess person. Everybody has their own sense of movement. The bishop can't move like a knight. The wazir can't move like a badshah. And yet everybody is supposed to be right there. At least on a chessboard, there is a pattern drawn. But in real life, they have to be just understood. They cannot be drawn. So here comes my teacher. I thought, what's the topic? It's called urban space in continuity. So as I would start a lecture, let us try and understand what these three things mean. Urban. Most of us are urbanites. Probably most of us are born urbanites. We don't understand anything but urban, but we don't understand what it is because we live in it. So that's, we will discuss urban. Next is space. Now this is intriguing because as architects and urban designers, we are supposed to be working with space. When somebody says, do you design buildings? We said, no, that's a civil engineer's job. We actually design space, and the walls and the columns and the beams and the roofs and the floors are supposed to only trap space or let the space go. And then there is continuity. Take one by one. Urban is very, very studied. Everybody understands what is urban. That's how it all started. Long, long ago, Mother Earth was nice, and then the human being started making their own tracks. Then they started making some little shelters, and one day the shelters became rather complicated. And it is that complicated shelter or settlement that we call urban. Urban basically means cities, it's civic, and it's got to do with civilization. There were people on Earth, especially in most parts of Africa, who refused to be civilized. Basically meant that they refused to make cities. There were some people who were from the eastern side of Mediterranean to almost the western side of Indus Valley or Indus, who wanted to be civilized. They wanted to make cities. So that's why we call them civilizations, and the word urban only matters to them. Of course, they spread, went into Greece, went into lots of other places, and somebody jumped across the Pacific and landed up in South America called Mesoamerican civilization. Today, these civilized people think that civilization is very, being civil is very good, so anybody who is non-civil is understood to be uncivilized, rather than being called primitive. One of the basic tenets of urban is that there is a premium on land, and therefore urban settlements are hugely tightly built, and there is always a huge discussion and a question mark on the word called space. Culturally, an urban area has to be crowded, and yet to an individual he is anonymous. Nobody knows him, but he is with lots of people. There is a meaning called public. In a rural area you will never say public corner, but in an urban area we will have this whole understanding of what is public. And in urban areas, you have institutions. Groups of people trying to work out something or trying to have some power or trying to tell other people what to do and what not to do. Then comes space. Now that's the big question mark. One doesn't know what space is. Well, to start with, space is from Earth to the next galaxy and beyond. And on Earth, the human being tried to do things by which he could start doing things with space. Otherwise, space didn't have any meaning. It's a non-tactile thing. But look at that wall. The moment he does that wall, there is a this side of it and a that side of it. Now he creates two spaces out of completely infinite space. And then he goes on and makes more walls, horizontal walls, vertical walls, and he starts carving out his tiny little space from within the huge nebulous space from here to the next galaxy and beyond. And he slowly tries to cover this up. But if you look at him, somewhere or the other, he cannot 100% disconnect with the space which is outside, which is still nebulous. And so even when he makes a house, he's still going to stand outside the door and gape at it, the outside space from where he basically came in. And eventually, when the civilization becomes more and more complex, he actually sits down and defines non-space. The space which is nebulous, he tries to enclose it, he tries to pattern it, he does all kinds of things in which he doesn't take shelter physically, but perhaps takes shelter mentally. And it is this space, which is basically an open space, very often public space, that we, in principle, call urban space. So space is open space and built space, very clearly. As a result, we designers of space design both voids as well as solids. And it's easier to design a solid, it's much more difficult to design a void. Right? But we live in the voids. I remember I had written a poem long ago. I'm not going to recite the poem, but the first two lines was that an architect can never ever avoid to incorporate in his design a void. That's how a designer works. And the last, which we are going to bash our heads today, is the word called continuity. That's another very intriguing word. I was thinking about it. So continuity can be yesterday, today, tomorrow. So it's a temporal continuity. It can be a typological continuity between the indoor and the outdoor and the beyond. There can be a hierarchical continuity called micro, macro, mega. So there are various kinds of continuities that one deals with. So that was yesterday. Some old shot of Delhi, nice and open, and now the next shot of Delhi. So this is what has happened over a period of time. Now as far as we are concerned, then we say, okay, what's going to happen tomorrow? I hope not. Sorry, I've got a bad language, sorry. So time makes change, and we use the word continuity. I was intrigued when some people said, what about discontinuity? And my point was that as long as time doesn't halt, there can be nothing called discontinuous. In fact, if there is anything called discontinuous at all, if we want to mean anything out of discontinuity, it is the happening of the discontinuity which forces continuity. Because if it wouldn't, it would be stagnant. And if discontinuity was absolute, then we might as well die. So there cannot be an absolute discontinuity. There has to be a continuity. It could be a drastic change. It can be a complete change. It could be a mild change. It could be a modification. It could be transformation. But nothing can be 100% discontinuous until and unless you are a dinosaur. But then only when dinosaurs left, we could come. Otherwise, there wouldn't be any plants left. So then comes this inside outside. This is a picture of a courtyard. A courtyard, which was, well, we can say all kinds of things, what happens in a courtyard. But one of the things that can happen in a courtyard is that you can hang your clothes to dry. Now, when the courtyard goes away, then what happens? So now you can go outside the house and you can trap the space in between two different houses and you can still have your clothes to dry. Now what happens if that is encroached by somebody else? So now what happens to this? So now you don't occupy a horizontal space on the ground, but you go out of your window and you capture a space which nobody objects and you have able to occupy. Right? So now, is this continuity? In my opinion, it is. The act of being able to get your clothes to get the sun or the air or the wind or whatever you want, and it can be done in various ways. Now, we can't stand there and say, oh shit, the courtyard is gone. Now what do we do? The courtyard is gone, so what? The point was not the courtyard. The point was that, did I need some space in which I can hang my clothes so that it can dry? So, that is also a continuity. Now, the last called micro, macro and mega. Let's look at this. This is a part of one of my thesis sheets. The top left shows basically the darker portions are rooms and the whiter portions in between are basically non-rooms. Now it could be a veranda, it could be a courtyard, it could be... And you see that how over a period of time, even today in India, fantastically, because time lives in parallel, you will find all kinds of houses, only single rooms without anything. You can have a room with a little veranda. You can have all kinds, and that's a continuity of how spaces occur and transform, club, complicate itself, and do all kinds of things. On the other hand, the bottom right one shows how an open space is trapped mathematically in a house, in a cluster or mohalla, and in a city, from an angle to a chowk to a maidan. It's an open space which has its own continuity or linkage. So if you have a link, you have a continuity. And that's why there is a personalized space and there is a collective space. The picture, none of them are from India. One is from the Middle East and the other one is from Nepal. So what basically says is that with time, what has happened? Now this is something interesting. What you see on the top two, the shaded portion is a built-up area. Now that's something called a house. What we find in our older cities is that we have a house which has got a hole in the middle and we call it a courtyard house. Now when we see a house today, we find that the center is what is built and there is this huge setback thing which is all around. So over a period of time, we have actually reversed the whole thing and we landed up from a courtyard to a bungalow. Can we use the space or not? How do we use the space? We don't know. But there is this relationship between an open space and a non-open space, even at a house level, remains exactly the same in a completely different order. Now, when you see what happens to a group of houses, what we call a small settlement or a piece of the settlement, you'll find that there is a drastic pattern difference between what is the old and the new. So what? I mean, all the streets have been straightened out because the car comes and moves. But that's not so easy. What we have to basically understand is that how did the settlement pattern on the left-hand side happen the way it happened? And how did the thing on the right-hand side happen the way it happened? Both were made by human beings. The human beings are the same. Do aankhein hoti hain, do haath the, do paon the, pehle bhi the, abhi bhi hai. So it's not that the human being has changed, but something in the way he does things has probably changed. And it is that we will see now. Now this diagram has now become a picture or a photograph. On the left hand side, you see that naturally our older settlements were like this. And on the right hand side, you will find that is what has happened to our settlements today. Now, how did it happen? The early settlements. Long, long ago, there was only Mother Earth, nice and open and green. Then three people came and they made three houses. And because they were friends or they were relatives, they came close to each other. Some more people came. Few more. And more. And more. And they made some things like temples and all that for themselves. What was left not built became the street. I don't consider it was a street. It was a space to access the places. But because each one came and made their own little house in their own nice way, what happened in between happened rather organically, spontaneously, and intuitively. Now what happens today? the later settlements. Whatever was left of the Mother Earth was still green. Somebody came and laid out the streets. Once they laid out the streets, then they divided them into plots. And then they said, DDA said, let's have a lottery. So whoever came, whoever got the money earlier, made little houses, tera mera on their own, having their own little things. And then after that, they found that there is no place to play. So they made small little greens. So the difference in the color, what was once upon a time much more integrated, has now landed up becoming extensions of streets which were deliberately done at a later date. And now if you want to interact in the green, you have to watch your watch and say, "Acha, 5 baj gaye ab chalte." In the earlier streets, you didn't have to have a 5 o'clock, you didn't have to have a 6 o'clock in the morning, you didn't have to have an afternoon sunning, because that was a integrated thing. Whatever was not inside the house was a part of the whole. But today, there is a very clear street and there is a very clear open space. So that is called planned and organized. So once upon a time, there were no streets, and now streets is the beginning point. So this is what happened to various kinds of settlements. If you just go through the points, you will realize that what happened very spontaneously now at the right bottom corner is so rigid and planned that then you actually hunt for where you want to have a public space, which actually is decided by geometry or number or some statistics. So this is how it is. And if you look at the rightmost bottom corner, you start realizing that in those kinds of grids, when the buildings start coming up and up and up, there are times when most of the human beings don't know what terra firma is. Right, so maybe we need a tiny pause out here. Perhaps we try and get the continuity in order. Guess we see thing and thought together. And this is something I would like to spend a few seconds on, that the universe is not made of atoms, and it's made of tiny stories. And that story is what I call the thought. All that we see is a thing. In profound language, it will be called form and content. But as far as I am concerned, my name starts with T, so I like T. So I thought I convert it, and I said there's a thing and a thought. Now, if you have a thing which does not have a thought, it's useless. Why? Because it doesn't have a meaning. Now, if you have a thought and you don't have a thing, then you say it's abstract. So until and unless you make a thing which has a thought, it does not mean anything to anybody. So if you just take a stone, which is a thing and doesn't have a thought, you just take a stone and you can do whatever you feel like and kick it all the way from here to the bus stop. But the moment you say, "Oh God, this is a shivling," or "There is a white thread out here," or you put a sindoor patika, and suddenly you get a thought to it, and then you start arguing ki ye Vishnu ka patthar hai ki Shiv ka. And that immediately, that same goddamn stone becomes a God-fearing stone. Okay? So this is an important point in my understanding of continuity. Do I take a continuity in its thingness? Or do I take continuity in its thoughtness? Now, what happens if a thing exists and the thought keeps changing? And I think that's what happens to our historical monuments. And I think that's what happens to certain spaces which once upon a time people used to try and go there, and then much later it became a kula dump. Why? Because the people stopped making sense to that place, they moved out somewhere else, the thing of that space still stayed, and because nobody now comes there, the garbage comes there. On the other hand, there could be that does a thought persist, and things can change because of whatever reasons. The politician comes and takes us. And just because he takes away the space, what I want to meet my people, I'll figure out some way of doing it. It doesn't matter if the space, I will crimp and I will cry, why did the politician take away, or why did DDA in the park has now made a school or a gym or a water pump cup, dabba. But my need, so if you don't give me a park to play, I'll play on the street. And then he said, well, the street is not supposed to be played upon, you know, the scooters and the cars and all that are supposed to be coming there. He said, okay, it doesn't matter. When the car will come, I'll stop playing. When the car will go, I'll start playing. So you mix and match. You can do all kinds of things because the thought, unfortunately, remained. You can take away the thing. And this is something which one has learned from children. You give a child, I mean, I remember when I was a child, I had a tricycle which broke. And I still remember vaguely, I used to get the tricycle upside down and it finally became a sabji ka thela. But I didn't have a sabji. It was an upside down tricycle with two of the wheels not there. But then one wheel which was there was good enough for me and I could shout and I had fictitious sabji on it and I used to sell it to all my neighbors. Was I a sabji wala? Yes or no? For me, I was. I was 100% next 15 minutes, I was a sabji wala. Without any sabji, without any thela. So whatever was there was a thela. So whatever thing was there, I could convert it to my thought. Right? Now, this is connectivity. And as long as connectivity is there, there cannot be discontinuity. Right? So, that's what is important for us to understand. Please keep that in mind. We will not use the word thing and thought again, probably today, during this slideshow at least. But keep that in mind and you will find that whatever this slideshow perhaps will keep on referring to that in the background. Yeah. So, continuity and discontinuity needs to be continuously argued in each one of our mind. Thing and a thought could be used as a tool to think. So now what happened? Why are we talking about continuity of urban space today? I mean, what the hell? I mean, urban areas are there, you are there, I am there. Why? Because somewhere I think we feel that our space has been either looted or it is polluted. All kinds of space, chahe wo open ho, private ho, public ho, covered ho, closed ho. And it is because of that that we are concerned and we are sitting here today. Space has been taken away. There was a time when we had chota-chota houses, one floor, two floor. Each house could have one car, two people going out. Now suddenly everybody says, this is not done, has increased the FAR. Now we have got the same plot with 40 houses on top of each other. Fantastic, you can even get people to do that. But then if 40 households have one car each, but the ground space is this much. So, 8 o'clock in the morning, 40 cars come out from that same plot where once upon a time only one car came out. In the evening, 40 cars are trying to reach that house where once upon a time only one car was destined to go there. As a result, you tried to widen the street. You widened and widened and widened till you couldn't widen anymore. So now you have a multi-story street. You make flyovers. You make underpasses. But you have basically first gone horizontal. So every damn space that you could have left, could have got once upon a time, long, long ago, when your houses were one floor or two floors high, have been eaten away by the car. Car has looted my open space. Yeah. And look at the street. This is a view from China. If God forbid, if we are going to... And look at the gall. They have a green space in the middle. So for calculation, they will say, so much of square foot is green. Or open. But who is going to reach that? Not the human being, nor the car. But at least I can say, okay, maybe the road is a nice urban space. You are actually on it. So what if you are inside a car? And in India it happens. Every time I stop at the traffic light, there will be people pani lena hai. Nowadays you get mukhali. Aajkal to gulab bhi milte hain. So if I want to suddenly figure out ki yaar ghar mein ja raha hoon. आज बहुत मैंने फोन वोन किया था मेरी वाइफ ने और जवाब नहीं दिया गुलाब का फूल ले चलते हैं उसके लिए उतरने की जरूरत नहीं है वो गाड़ी में ही मिल जाती है सो इज माई स्ट्रीट अगेन इन अनदर वे कमिंग बैक टू मी आई डोंट नो देर वॉज अ टाइम व्हेन वी वुड ऑल सडनली एट आईटीओ would go in a circle, and there would be this little kid and a little less little kid who would be doing kalabajis. Today they are doing it, I'm sorry on the black tarmac, but they're doing it. So every time my car stops at a traffic light, you will find two kids trying to somersault and asking you for money. The cars are not standing in a circle anymore. But somewhere, it's there. You feel bad perhaps that this should not be the way it should be. But what I'm saying is that because the thought is there, because I'm still the audience, and that acrobat is still the person who needs the money by acrobating. The thought is there, the thing is gone, so we feel bad about that, that there's a conflict, but it does not mean that the thought has disappeared. Nothing has been, nothing has died. It may have got diseased, polluted.
Yeah.
And we take it further. We make these flyovers and we get these stupid negative places which nobody can reach, and then somebody comes and landscapes it. And we go around and saying, wow. But actually these open spaces are so fantastically useless. And here is thing after thing after thing after thing without any thought. Right? It's there, but it's not there. So why is the acrobat on the street? Why is the acrobat not in that open space in that corner under the flyover? When you ask a planner, he will say space to diya hai. Jitna space pehle tha, percentage road versus non-road, I have still given it. Right. So things are there. And as far as thought is concerned, something has gone away. Okay. Fantastic. More. I remember my childhood. जब कुछ नहीं करने को होता था, हम लोग के पास टीवी तो वैसे ही नहीं था, व्हाट्सएप भी नहीं था, मोबाइल ही नहीं था, जब एकदम मतलब जिंदगी से बेकार हो जाते थे घर पे, तो कहाँ बाहर जा रहे हैं टहलने, टहलने कहाँ जाते हैं, बाजार हो गया आपको, बाजार में क्या करना है पता नहीं, मतलब बाजार है, घूमने जाते हैं, चले जाते हैं, दो चार यार दोस्त मिल गए, घूम घाम आए, चाय की दुकान मिल गई, पान की दुकान मिल गई, पी ली. उस समय कॉलेज में थे, फुटबॉल खेलते थे, तो सिगरेट पीना अलाउड नहीं था, इसीलिए सिगरेट नहीं पीते थे, तो थोड़ी देर के बाद वो भी कर लेते थे, या मेरे से कुछ सीनियर लोग थे वो तो कर लिया करते थे. बाजार, अब बाजार में कौन जाएगा? देयर इज सपोज्ड टू बी अ लीनियर प्लाजा इन नेहरू प्लेस. आई मीन आई हैव स्पोकन टू द आर्किटेक्ट, पुअर गाय, आई मीन ही हैज डन इट विद ऑल गुड इंटेंशंस, बट बिकॉज द पार्किंग इज आउटसाइड द बाजार, बाय द टाइम यू वॉन्ट टू गो फ्रॉम द होम टू दैट स्ट्रीट, you have to cross some 50 cars and you say, ki, what the hell? Because from the home, you couldn't just step out and say, main to bazaar mein aa gaya. Right? How many of you go to the mall? Kya karne jaate ho? Saturday, Sunday, I live in Noida. GIT mall ke sadak se nikalna ya guzarna bhi mushkil ho jata hai, kyunki wahan par kam se kam 150 gaadiyan khadi hui hain andar jaane ke liye. But when you ask them, अच्छा बाजार में कुछ खरीदने जा रहे हो क्या मॉल में? नहीं. And they're all youngsters, the same youngsters where I was 35 years ago. सिर्फ ये थी कि मैं जिस बाजार में टहलता था उस पर छत नहीं थी, वो एयर कंडीशन नहीं था. लेकिन मेरा बेटा जब जाता है वो भी टहल रहा है. बेसिकली कुछ खरीदना वरीदना नहीं है, बहुत कुछ हो जाएगा तो ये सॉफ्टी ले लेगा. हम चाय पी लेते थे, वो कॉफी पी लेता है, बट बेसिकली वो भी टहल रहा है, वो भी टूल रहा है, जिसको यूपी में बोला जाता है टूलने गए हैं. थिंग में चेंज आ गया है, थॉट में चेंज नहीं आया. सो दैट इज समथिंग वी हैव टू आई मीन रिकॉग्नाइज. नाउ वी मे से मॉल का कल्चर बहुत खराब है, आई डोंट नो, आई मीन आई रियली डोंट नो, बिकॉज आई कैन सी दैट इट इज द सेम डैम कल्चर. Absolutely the same damn culture, right? It's just a different manifestation, and take it or leave it. When the thing changes, material change hoga, thodi usme smell mein change hogi, thoda taste mein change hoga, hoga. But fundamentally, shayad kuch nahi hua hai. Now comes urban space. Traditionally, classically, as per the book, these are urban spaces. फ्रेंकली स्पीकिंग शहर के लोग कम जाते हैं, टूरिस्ट लोग वहाँ ज़्यादा जाते हैं. So, okay, some of us desperately, because we don't have any other place to go, chal yaar India ke chalte hain. लेकिन अगर एक घर के पास कुछ होता तो बड़ा मजा आता, राइट? अब नहीं है तो अब ठीक है, अब क्या कर सकते हैं. बट एक्चुअली दीज फैंटास्टिक अर्बन स्पेसेस आर एनीथिंग बट अर्बन. आई मीन दे आर अर्बन बिकॉज दे आर इन द अर्बन एरिया, बट फॉर द सिटीजन, फॉर द एक्चुअल अर्बनाइट, इट हैज गॉट लेस चार्म. बट यू फाइंड 75% ऑफ द पीपल इन एनी ऑफ दीज स्पेसेस फ्रॉम आउटसाइड द सिटी विद कैमराज, फोटोग्राफ्स, ऐसे खड़े होंगे, वैसे खड़े होंगे, जो भी है, मतलब उनके काम में आती है, हमारे काम में नहीं आती है, राइट? हमारे काम में क्या आती है, राइट? फ्रॉम मैरियो मिरांडा, देयर आर वेरियस काइंड्स ऑफ स्पेसेस व्हिच एक्चुअली आर पार्ट ऑफ द स्ट्रीट. सो आई ऑलवेज अंडरस्टूड, एंड दैट्स व्हाई, दैट्स हाउ आई वाज इंट्रोड्यूस्ड आल्सो टू यू, that when the Kathputli colony thing came up, my whole understanding about the Kathputli colony was that the majority of the people of the Kathputli colony were street performers. Now, as the streets are becoming roads, those poor guys don't have a place to perform, so now they are performing on the roads. And that's the whole, I mean, that's what has happened, but unfortunately, culturally, they are not road performers. The traffic police is the road performer, right? So the street performer, if you remove the street, so that's what's there. Now, should we bring back the street? Now, this is again the thing and the thought concept, right? The thing of that. Do you think as a teacher, I need a classroom? Well, I've been now been telling, why don't you go online? Classroom ki kya zarurat hai? Student will be sitting in his room, you will be sitting in your room, we don't need a classroom. And you are saying, nahi yaar, jab tak eye contact nahi hoga na, just imagine the street performer. I knew of a magician, he's now no more, lived in Kathputli colony, called Chand Baba. He was fabulous. He was a fabulous street. His younger brother, Chand Pasha, eventually transformed himself, became a stage performer. But Chand Baba, the elder bhai, refused to step onto the stage. He says, I'm a street performer. It's like, I'm a disco dancer, so I'm a street performer, I will be on the street. And he was absolutely gorgeous. Now you remove the street from yourself, Chand Baba, online aajo. I thought 80% of the streets were not hath ki safai, they were illusion. Online pe illusion karke dikha do. Right? So sometimes, everything cannot get into another thing. Something. So, should Chand Pasha die? He's dead. Should Chand Pasha's die? Or Chand Baba's die? Chand Pasha's survive? Chand Pasha's son is 100% stage magician. You ask him to come to the streets? No, sir. He will not be able to come. He doesn't have a Jadu ka pitara. Chand Baba had a Jadu ka pitara, which was a very nice little bag. I don't know how many. पैबन उसमें लगे हुए थे, कंधे पर डाल के वो जाता था, एंड ही वाज गुड. सो देयर विल बी चेंजेस, या देयर विल बी चेंजेस. सो दैट वाज द फोटोग्राफ एट द बॉटम. टू ऑफ माय स्टूडेंट्स हु आर नॉट इन इंडिया, प्रोबेबली इन यूके, व्हाट दे आर शोइंग इज दैट मॉल. द फोटोग्राफ राइट अबव दैट इज प्रोबेबली फ्रॉम श्रीनगर एंटायर मार्केट. But then this is what has happened. The car comes in between you and the shop and creates a buffer. Right? Now, how do we handle it? So, easier to handle in a mall is to sink it inside. So, the car goes underground, like our Dawood Ibrahim goes underground. So, the car goes underground, and then what is left on top can be safely used. So, everybody says, no, the car is the bad guy. So, new age change. There is a controlled microclimate. My son wouldn't walk the streets of what I would walk in Lucknow called Daliganj, because he would say, kitni garmi hai, kitna dhool hai, smell aa rahi hai car ke fumes ka. So he goes into a controlled microclimate, which is basically called a mall. Now, aren't we all in a controlled microclimate? I don't think my father ever had an AC. Now, I need an AC now and then, now and then, now and then. My son cannot stay without an AC. Perfectly all right. You need an AC here. So we are basically microclimating ourselves. बाहर बहुत गर्मी है तो अंदर आ जा, क्यों? क्योंकि बाहर तो भगवान ने गर्मी की है, अंदर हम ठंडा कर देते हैं. बाहर बहुत ठंडी है, अंदर आ जा, क्यों? क्योंकि भगवान ने तो बाहर ठंड की है, हम गर्मी कर देते हैं. बाहर बारिश हो रही है, बेटा मत भीगो, अंदर आ जाओ, क्योंकि बाहर तो भगवान ने बारिश की है, मैं उसको अंदर रोक देता हूं. सो दिस माइक्रोक्लाइमेटिक थिंग इज आवर डूइंग एंड वी आर नाउ माइक्रोक्लाइमेटिक मोर एंड मोर एंड मोर एंड मोर एंड मोर. सो ऑल दैट अर्बन स्पेस की कहानी जो कि हम लोग वी आर ट्राइंग टू सॉर्ट ऑफ लिंक इट विद ओपन स्पेस, प्रोबेबली वी हैव टू रीथिंक अबाउट द वर्ड ओपन, दैट क्वालिफायर. Right? But we may not necessarily need to rethink about the word public. But there are still things happening. This is a very recent photographs, again, sent in by other people. I have just picked them up from Facebook. So if anybody has taken this photograph, please get acknowledged. These spaces still are there. Are they urban? Well, I guess so, because this kind of a photograph you will never get in any damn village. It can't be rural. But this is where everybody is meeting everybody else and they are very glad about it. Hi. Courtyard. Darwaze ke bahar khade hoke auron ko taakna. Those things are gone. Because the pace of life has become too much. Who's going to spend time? I mean, can you imagine courtyard mein kuye se paani nikal ke bathroom mein le jaake nahana? Oh my God. पानी की टंकी से पानी खुद तो निकाल नहीं सकते, पाइप में आना जरूरी है. तो इस कोटियाड की अब क्या जरूरत है? नहीं जरूरत है. बाहर खड़े होने का टाइम केबीसी चल रहा था. बाहर खड़े किसको देखेंगे? सारे तो 40 किलोमीटर पर आवर की स्पीड से चले जाए. सो बाय द टाइम आई कुड रिकॉग्नाइज ये गाड़ी किसकी है चली गई. पहले लोग पैदल चलते थे तो बोलते हाँ जी जयराम जी की नमस्ते, कैसे घर में सब ठीक ठाक? तो अब वो है ही नहीं. वो बंदा इतनी स्पीड से निकल जाता है कि उसको हम पूछ ही नहीं सकते, हल्लो हाय करने का कोई जगह ही नहीं है. सो व्हाई डू वी वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग फोटोग्राफ्स, राइट? वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग फोटोग्राफ. एवरी आर्किटेक्ट्स थीसिस कैन बी डन ऑन दिस. बट दिस कैन टेक एनी ऑफ दी स्ट्रीट्स ऑन विच यू कैन ड्राइव एंड विदाउट ड्राइविंग इंस्ट्रूमेंट, चाहे वो टू व्हीलर हो चाहे थ्री व्हीलर या फोर व्हीलर, हाउ कैन वी सर्वाइव टूडे? नॉट पॉसिबल. Right? So tiny urban spaces are actually everywhere, and we can have a look. Now comes the contrast, as Ranjit Das says, no, opinionated. Yeah. Remember the same India Gate we had one slide before, public space, right? Now this is a fantastic photograph. All people have gathered together Makar Sankranti. Peron se we have got these charkis coming down. Nice installations, mobiles or whatever, and there are people on the floor. I don't know how many of them can fly the kite, but it doesn't matter. I mean, it should be there, but it's actually, I mean, kite is the excuse. Everybody's trying to come to an urban space. Now, here I get a fantastic idea. Like we said, we have lost ground, we have lost land. The amount of ground that we have lost, we actually have on our rooftops. I still remember my first love letter came across a parapet wall. And I was not interested, somebody else was interested, somebody else bid out the taka. And at 3 o'clock in the afternoon on a winter holiday, I was supposed to go on. I mean, I was anyway there at 3 o'clock because I had to, you know, I loved reading my Asimovs there. A lot of things happened across the rooftops. We had charpais on the rooftops. We slept at night, didn't have AC, so we slept at night on the rooftops. And I know all my saptarshis and one of the rishi's wife is there on the sky, because my grandfather would look, well, he's also looking up at the sky, I'm also looking up at the sky, neither with a rainy. Right? And in Bhopal, where my dad and mom used to stay, we used to shout across because we had friends in nearby houses, and we would lie down on the bed and would yell at the top of the voice. अभी क्या कर रहा है? And the mother said, "Shut up." Right, so there used to be a lot of communication. और अगर एक पतंग कटती थी, oh my God, what steeplechase? jump across parapet walls from rooftop to rooftop to rooftop till we get that dam cut. So much so that in a place like Banaras, you don't have to bother about two houses joining to each other. Because anyway, the gullies are 4 feet wide. By the upper floor, the balconies have come out. So by the time the rooftop has happened, one rooftop to another rooftop is hardly 2.5 feet away. So one remembered jumping over the streets onto another house. It did a lot of other things also. Stabbing was very easy. Gundagardi, you stab, climb up, go onto the rooftop, come out in another gully. While the policeman is in the gully, trying to figure out where to go. So you will find all riots happen in Purane Shahar. Can you ever have a riot in Chandigarh? You can't even snatch a gale ka haar in Chandigarh. If somebody comes and snatches my haar and tries to run, I can actually wait. Kaan jayega. Because he can't go out of my sight. Then I can take my gun and say, okay, I'm shooting up. But in Banaras, you snatch and you disappear. By the time you realize what happened, there are 3 bends. Adhe baaye jao, adhe daaye jao, baaki hamare saath aao. Right? Now this is now happening on the ground floor and 4 floors above. Have we ever understood what happened to the 4 floors above? I think today, unfortunately, the syntax tank has taken over the world. But if we can somehow figure that out, we have a treasure trove of open space. I am now seeing some of the builder houses getting some small little piggly gardens on top. I hope it will, something will happen perhaps. So, this photograph is not a photograph, this is a picture of an artist's view of one of the, probably the oldest archaeological remains of a settlement which might be called urban on earth. And it is taken as 7000 BC, more than 7000 BC, so it's close to 10,000 years old. It's a place called Katal Hyuk, in which the houses did not have an entry from the side. There were houses, they were packed together in such a way that there were enough houses in the middle where you couldn't have any entry from the side. So they actually entered from the top. So that means that the entire rooftop was a complete public domain. So people had to actually move around, and only when they had to sleep, they would wander around. They were like moles. 10,000 years and Banaras still exists with the rooftops. Is there a continuity? Possible. No continuity? Okay. Up to you. Right? So, Katal Hyuk is a fantastic example. There are still vernacular settlements in the Middle East where people can actually take a briefcase and walk on the roof to go from one place to the other. Hope. After all, civilization started from there. What can you do? And look at me. Flatted apartments. People are now slowly getting gardens which they can't get at the bottom because they are not on the ground. They are getting it. So they are creating various grounds. They are vertically going and creating various grounds. Until now, it is only up to potted plants. If we think a little better, I guess we can do all kinds of things. So, do hit the roof. There is space out there. The last. I'm sure this one is very clear. Our college is forcing down online on us. But that's a reality. Why should I have an open space on the street anymore? Is there any point? Right? So the open space is actually in their hands. And they are fantastically public because they are actually chatting with people. Right? Just like on an open space, I would like to say hello, hi. They're only saying hello, hi. And they're on the street. Right? Thought is there. Thing. changed, whatever. And this is my pet slide. I mean, I know, not my pet slide, I love it. So that's the understanding of outside. So virtually virtuous, a new urban space is in the offing. I am connected with more than 2,000 people on Facebook. And I am having a happy birthday, almost 3 to 4 people per day. Am I connected? Am I having a social life? So, I guess it's time for a conversation between you and us. Thank you.
Hello. An exciting talk from Tapan. Covers a very broad spectrum of issues and history, looks at contemporary life, looks at cities, looks at villages, and the whole wide spectrum that we looked at. And I think it opens up a kind of very intensive aspect of what modern life is, I guess, to a certain extent. And what are these values we don't value, and how does sort of progression and society happen with the changes in values, changes in spaces, changes in attitudes, and so on and so forth. It brings about, I think, a lot of questions that people might have, and I think from the audience that we have here, what we'd like to do now is to open this up to discussions, and let's discuss, clarify, add, subtract, have an opinion about what one would like to do. But I would just like to congratulate Tapan for putting this very broad spectrum across it. And something that one wishes to ponder about, and to wonder that, you know, where are we going, which way is it taking us? Is it the motor car, or is it the kind of communication that we deal with today? And isn't this very wonderful maze of spaces that we live and we communicate in, both in the real world, in the virtual world, and in sort of seamless areas, and very compartmentalized areas. So, you know, the spectrum is very, very large. I think the kind of range that he's talked about, and would be very interesting to get your opinions. We have enough time. I request whoever would like to express their views, ask questions, be kindly, be brief, and we begin the discussions or questions that you might have.
Yeah, so I wanted to ask you talked about thought and think. So I was thinking about it in terms of anatomy and morphology of the human body. That if, for instance, I have various organs, but if my nasal cavity isn't getting clogged up, I don't need to cough it out or spit it out. But when I do, then that's a morphological fact. So that's a thought that has brought upon into it. I don't want to vomit, that's why. So I was thinking, for instance, some really big budgeted films get made in which a lot of thought has gone into the architecture, so to say, the sets, what are called, and the props, and the locations, how they're dressed up, or what angles they are lighted from and photographed from. I was thinking, a lot of them fall flat as cinema. They're not poetry, as cinema is poetry, but cinema is prose, because all the thought that has gone into the architecture, for instance, the landscaping, whatever, for instance, the Hobbit films actually turned a place into an actual Shire location for the Hobbits of the Shire or whatever. So that doesn't make it poetic. It is as cinema, because in a rectangular frame, how do you make it poetic? So it is just a prospect. They are prospecting. So that's prose in a way. So I was thinking how to put thought into frames of cinema rather than just leaving it at, as a design details for cinema. Because I'm, because poetry goes into making props as well, but that poetry doesn't translate, as you said. For instance, a magician, if he or she is performing tricks on camera, some of the magic might slip out. So similarly, how to make directors and designers for cinema? I'm calling them designers, though they are also poets many times. But for cinema, how do they show their poetry? How do the directors show their poetry and infuse their own poetry into the frames? So I was, for instance, thinking that.
Would you like me to comment? If you don't
yeah.
frankly speaking, because I'm not a person who knows anything about cinema, and neither I am, and forget about being an expert. I really don't know how you can, but what I mean, in a very vague way, I'll say that, like, I understand that people like Satyajit Ray or people like Shyam Benegal are supposed to be thinking directors. Thinking directors, and therefore, their movies have carried value for a longer period of time. I mean, that's all that I can say. But so it's very difficult for me to answer a question that how one can do it in the cinema, because I'm not a person who has ever handled cinema, so I will not be able to. But I can. But one thing that I would like to sort of, you gave some kind of a, you know, in the beginning, the first sentence that you said about the human body. Now, on the thing and the thought when I was thinking about the human body, I felt that, you know, there was a joke sometimes back I read. I mean, not really a joke, one of these kind of, you know, humorous things, when they said that Jatak, as long as I am still alive, you will always call me Tapan or whatever, sir, mister, whatever. The moment I die, you will say body utha ke yahan rakh de. Nobody will say Tapan ko utha ke yahan rakh de. Right? Now, that's the fantastic thing. So, I mean, it's a very interesting, I mean, when I read that, it made a lot of, I mean, never thought about it, right? As long, jab tak meri saans chalegi, you will use my name. The moment meri saans band ho jayegi, you will stop using my name. So my name went where? Memory. Whatever, we call it soul, we call it saans, we call it whatever. So my name went with that. So now the moment that thing happened, the thought went, and what is left is just a thing, and you actually call it like a thing. Body ko sambhal ke rakhna, body ko udhar ghuma ke rakhna, shab ke liye le ja rahe hain. Insaan ko nahi le ja rahe, insaan nahi. So that is what I meant by actually the thing and the thought. See, every action that you do will have some thinking, because otherwise, even if you're going to make money, you're going to make money. So that's the thinking, right? So it's more like what I would say, substance. So I'm using the think and the thought because it's a very simple, ordinary, stray language. Otherwise, people would call it substance. So if there's no substance, then is there, so, I mean, why should you do something? You can still do something. Nobody can stop you from not doing something. It's just that, will it carry? Will it carry itself? That's about that. Exactly how you do it in film, I have no clue. Do you have any clue?
Yeah, I was wondering whether you asked.
Yes, you know.
Not that.
No, that's not really good. Yes, please.
You see, in your lecture, that also included the that we are losing space or it is being changed. Do you think that it could be helped in a very drastic manner, or it's an evolution, natural evolution, and it had to be there? Or you think it could have been different, you know, in a very drastic manner?
Well, telling the truth, I mean, one is that I have left it as a question because I don't think anybody has got an answer. The other thing, I mean, yesterday also we were sitting with architecture students and all that, we were talking about this trying to create change. And I personally feel that I am, being a part of the world, I am subject to change rather than I can ever be a precipitator of change. Right, I don't think so, because that is almost like, I mean, even if we pretend to be humble, it's trying to play God. So I don't think that I can precipitate change. And anybody who thinks who can precipitate change, I have a problem with them. Khalifa nahi ban sakte, Messiah nahi ban sakte. These things are happening. Like, I mean, I remember again, I mean, when my son was behaving the way he was behaving in the beginning, I was saying that, I mean, kya hai dimag kharab hai iska. Right, but when you sort of sit down later and says, well, how was I to my dad? And then I recognized that I was different from my dad. And I did all kinds of things which my dad never understood. Now those things I am still thinking that my son will do to me, but he doesn't. He's doing something else, which I don't understand. So I am part of the chain. Now the faster I understand that I am part of the change and not resist the change, probably the better I will be. Now the change, you may say that some changes evolutionary, all changes are evolutionary, because I said it's continuous. So some changes are taking you to the direction which may not be at the end very happy, and some will take you to the direction which might be happy. I am a staunch believer of destiny, you may like it or not, but I think that's what happens. And I mean, you sometimes, like, I believe in that Gita's thing, ki yata yata dharma, something happens. So maybe there's a Mahatma Gandhi who will come, or there will be Raja Ram Mohan, I'll change the world, and they will probably change the world. But most of us, we are part of the world. I mean, we don't basically, I mean, that's what I think.
Please use the mic.
How do you see the future?
Just doing great things, and a lot of people can't see. You like to come to this side. You know, this lectern is kind of obstructing them. If you don't, if somebody like to, just come across to the other side. Just move across. Okay. Yeah, please carry. Sorry.
How do you see the future of these places where the space is organized organically? How do you see they will change?
They will have to change. I mean, the point is that it's not a question of done organically or not. The point is that I can't see a future because I'm not an astrologer. I can't see future. I don't have a crystal ball. I can't see future. But organically evolved settlements have happened in the past. The infrastructures that are, I mean, why did we get into planning? We got into planning because, not because of anything else, but basically we wanted to distribute the resources in a more orderly manner so that we can control it. Now those resources are now a reality in life. You may say that, why should electricity be there? I mean, can't be. I mean, there are thousands of years people live without electricity and they're perfectly happy, they're still alive. I mean, we are alive because they were alive. So, but we have gotten into that bad habit or whatever, right? So electricity has to be given, sewer lines will have to be put, and you know, we'll have to pollute, I mean, Yamuna by putting all the sewer at one place. So we will do all those kinds of things. So those will put pressure on the kind of forms that they have, because those forms, when they came about, may not be planned, but when they came about, did not have these as context. Now the context has changed, there will be conflict, right? There will be contradictions and there will be conflicts. In the beginning there will be negotiation. In that negotiation, whatever modifications and transformations will happen. If by that it can continue, fantastic. If it can't, it will be made to, the thing will be made to discontinue and then redone. So you can entirely demolish, let us say, Shahjahanabad and rebuild it so that the sewer lines and everything can be put in. Now you would be very sentimental. No, why? I mean, you can't do that. Right? So you can be sentimental about it and not allow it to be done and live with the contradiction and the conflict. Right? But there may be situations where a particular settlement or a portion of a settlement is simply not in a position to negotiate sufficiently to be happy. So either you choose to remain unhappy or you try and say, okay, change, be happy, let be. I mean, part of Darya Ganj did get demolished and rebuilt. But what happens today if we go there? Do we always get tears in our eyes? I don't think so. But at that time it must have happened. There must have been enough tears. But today we go and take photographs and say, Pata, that's a part of our research. So, again, as I said, cannot predict and don't even try to predict future, because I think, I know, we are very scared about future. That's why, so all that we can do is that we can go to an astrologer, maybe if they put a particular amuti in everybody's hands who live in that settlement and things can sort of work out, maybe they can, but I won't predict.
Yes, I have a very simple question.
For urban areas, we say it's an inclusive thing. But then when we came to your last slides, we saw the people with their mobile phones having their own inclusive or exclusive space where they interacted. So, as a designer or planner, we see future urban spaces as inclusive or as an exclusive space for dwellers.
Well, in the beginning what I said was that urban area is a place where there's a lot of crowd, but everybody is a lonely person. I don't know where are we inclusive. You come to a movie hall, you see movie, you only come with the person you have come along with. Right. So when we go to even, let us say, India Gate, we don't go around shaking hands with everybody who has come to India Gate. Nice meeting. We don't do that. I mean, if I go with Ranjita, I will go with Ranjita, we will have an ice cream and we'll do whatever, and we will ogle at people or whatever we will do. But we'll never go and say, like, you know, sasame media. We'll never. So I don't know if we are really inclusive. So even when these guys are walking next to each other, you will still find.
To conserve another way.
You know, I mean, that much is there, then they disappear. Now, that chat that they are doing, so what they are doing, they are in an urban space. But that urban space is not at their feet. That urban space is everywhere. And you can at least, you can chat with half a dozen people. So you are there, and this disappearing. See, people like us don't understand that. We don't fully, I mean, kya kar rahe hain log? But I have seen people doing that. I travel in the metro. 90% of the girls who get into the metro, the moment they step in, they disappear in the phone. Why? Because they know that there are too many people who are looking at them. Now how do they disappear? They physically can't disappear. So they mentally disappear. They go into their phone. They go into their phone and the friends with whom she is talking to, he's with that person. She's smiling, she's laughing, she's getting angry, she's getting emotional, she's getting upset, whatever. She's not here. So all those people were staring at her. Nice girl. Right? She is oblivious. Now, try to understand. I mean, this is a very different perception of space. And first I thought, it became irritating for me. I mean, these people, I mean, this generation, these people. Slowly, as I kept seeing every day more and more and more and more people, I started realizing that, look, this is what they're doing. This is what they're doing. I remember at my generation, a lot of girls used to carry large bags. And I said, kyun le ja rahe ho? Sense of security. It's a very, very nice thing to hold the bag between you and another person in DTC bus. So what you do, there are too many things that you do, and not all of us, all of it is in the bag or in the book, and you don't understand, right? But it's for us to sort of see, watch, understand, and be continuously kyun. And there are a lot of things. So I don't know. Actually, he's being inclusive. He's actually there with lot many people. My son today says, I'm not an Indian, I'm a global citizen. He's right. He has no boundaries. Today, if I want to call up somebody in US, at my time, we had to go all the way to Janpath and then stand in a queue and then try to sort of get a call through. I understood how far was US. Today, I just go out on the veranda, I just sort of light my cigarette, call off and say happy birthday, done. Right, so I thought the distance still remains the same, but does it? So that is what, I mean, what is inclusive and what is exclusive, and very soon you will probably be getting all the faces and everything on your phone. I mean, it's there, the technology is there, right? And you will be talking to that person, and it's possible. I mean, it is there, actually it's there. So. And you're doing it on the Skype anyways. Yes. So these are the things. I mean, the definitions of inclusive and exclusive probably have to alter. I mean, that's what I understand. Yeah.
Sorry. If you were given choice of living in a settlement like Banaras in Noida
or the place right now you're staying at, which one would you take? And maybe I want to make my point, like in past, like call it Katanoe or Banaras, people were off the place, they knew each other. But right now, as a society, as you know, professions, you don't know each other. So maybe that, you know, the answer is not going back to that particular kind of settlement. Maybe something in the middle. Or maybe I see something is happening, maybe in SBA campus or IIT campus, when people know each other. You can try out something like that, like organic settlement, and you can try something different. But yeah, so.
Your contradiction is coming basically because, as I said, that the thing has outstayed. The thing has overstayed its utility. Banaras was fantastic place once upon a time, long, long ago in the days of. But today, it's becoming a contradiction with the way of life. I don't care if the life today is better. I mean, I'm sick of understanding that we had good old days of life. There's nothing called good old days of life. This is the life. Right? Good, bad, or ugly. Right. Today, I cannot stay in Banaras because I can't. I mean, I was born and brought up in a place in Lucknow which was very close to that kind of an action place where you step out of the house and you are on the street. But those days are different. Now, today, that's my life. I mean, perhaps in Banaras it won't work. But you take SPA, Sushant School, Pearl Academy to Banaras, maybe it'll work. So I have other allegiances, I have other reasons, I have other rationale. When I come back at 8 o'clock at night. I mean, where in the daytime I am going to be on the rooftop? Where am I going to meet the other person right across the gully? When I am going to stand there and say hello, hi? Right, it's not there. I'm traveling 2 hours up and down each way, every day. Right, so that's reality, right? So I'm, okay, reality check. So actually today I want a house which is so far away from streets so that no thieves can ever climb my window. Right, it should be a gated community where I'm not there most of the time. So as a result, it's a completely different thing. I mean, where is society? In fact, I am actually looking forward when I go to the college that I'll meet people. That's it. So it will change. Now, again, are some of these buildings outlived? It was made by some generation. Unfortunately, we use a construction and a material which outlived the person. I mean, yesterday we were discussing the same thing again, as I said in SPA. Then why can't we make a house? Why can't I make a house with a process and material which will die with me? So that my next generation can do it his or her way. Is it possible? I don't know. What to do?
मैं अपने शहर को क्या कहूँ, सरकार कुछ नए शहर बना रही है जिनको वो स्मार्ट सिटी कहेगी, तो क्या मैं अभी इस शहर कहूँ? दूसरा, मेरे शहर में जो थिंग और थॉट का रिलेशन है, उनके शहर में अगर वो वैसा नहीं होगा, तो मेरी मानसिकता पे उसका क्या असर होगा?
आप नाराज हो जाएंगे, आप नाराज हो जाएंगे और बोलेंगे कि उस शहर से मेरा कोई लेना देना नहीं, क्योंकि अपने हिसाब से हर शहर अलग है. जैसे आपके पीछे बैठे हुए भाई साहब कह रहे थे कि क्या मैं बनारस में वापस जा सकता हूँ. बनारस बहुत खूबसूरत जगह है लेकिन शायद मेरे काम की नहीं है. तो इसी तरीके से अब मेरे लिए दिल्ली नया बनारस है, आज का बनारस है. वो ये मोदी सरकार अब एक और नया बनारस बनाएगी, शायद मेरे काम की नहीं होगी, लेकिन वहां पर जिन लोग रहेंगे वो मेरी दिल्ली को अगर बोलेंगे पता नहीं क्या बकवास है. सो यस, एवरीथिंग विल नॉट work with us. We are too large a group of people. But industrial mindset dheere, agar aise hi chalta rahe, toh mere khayal se wo bhi ho jayega. Because hum hi log bol rahe hain, China mein log bol rahe hain, America ke shahar dekh ke aao, yahan par banao. Hamare neta bol rahe hain, China mein dekh ke aao, aur waisa banao. So finally, if A is equal to B and B is equal to C, then C is equal to A. So if all over the world, similarly all buildings will become Banaras, na? So, I mean, some other, whichever Banaras. So, maybe, but it will change, it will continue. I mean, that's what fantastic thing about it is, I guess.
So, hum log kya kahenge apne aap?
Hum log
chhod jayenge Banaras mein, wo kya soch?
Nahin, lekin jo aapke pehle wale shahar hain, jisme aap rehte hain, unko to nahin badal payenge na, wo to wahi rahega. So, aap bhi rahenge. In fact, that is what is fantastic about this country. I mean, I love my country because of that.
that the car can come in, the motorcycle can come in, but the Balgali doesn't die. And if I go to US, if I go to UK, Balgali khatam ho chuki, ghoda gali khatam ho chuki, hamari yahan nahi hui abhi tak. So we have many things happening simultaneously. Time for us is fascinatingly repeated. So we'll probably be still better. I will be much better. I'm sure.
उसमें रोबोटिक आदमी रह रहे हैं तो क्या उनके अंदर आगे जाके कभी संवेदना भी आएगी, मेरा एक सवाल है। और दूसरा जो स्मार्ट सिटी है उसमें सब चीजें हैं क्योंकि रोबोट के थ्रू होंगी, कहीं और से नियंत्रित हो जाएंगे, तो क्या आदमी भी उसी ढंग से बैक टू फूड लेके घर में जाएगा और माता जी पिताजी से आप हाय हेलो करके निकल आएगा, ऐसा कुछ होगा?
मुझे मालूम नहीं है कि शायद वो हाय हेलो भी कर पाएगा। आई डोंट नो, आई मीन हाउ मच टाइम डू वी हैव। आज से 5-6 महीने पहले देयर वाज वन स्टूडेंट फ्रॉम निफ्ट हु केम टू माय कॉलेज टू सम टॉक डिस्कस समथिंग एंड ही वाज रेफर्ड टू बाय वन ऑफ माय ओल्ड स्टूडेंट्स। वो कालकी डिजाइन कर रहा था, इज अ कम्युनिकेशन डिजाइनर। He wanted to first design Kalki and then present it to as a final year project. Kalki आपको पता है जिससे apocalypse कह लीजिए, मतलब कलयुग खत्म होगा। And the discussion that went on for about 2 hours, finally I said मेरा class में कुछ जाने दे। Will Kalki be a male or a female? कालका समझ सकते हैं, वो भी female। तो Kalki is a male or a female? And we had a long discussion that if over a period of time the male, whose only utility on earth is a few seconds to become a father, right? And that also can be now banned, right? Should a male be required anymore, right? So there is a possibility that Kalki is a gender which you don't have to bother about male or female because the male doesn't exist. Right, so there is only one gender. Then the thing was that कहा जाता है घोड़े पे आएगा, तो इज ही हाफ हॉर्स हाफ ह्यूमन? इज इट कांट बी, देन दे आर गोइंग बैक टू ग्रीस। इफ यू लुक एट ऑल द अदर अवतार्स, दे हैव अ स्टोरी ऑफ एवोल्यूशन। तो घोड़ा तो बहुत पहले खत्म हो चुका है क्योंकि बामन आ चुका है, बाकी सब आ चुके हैं, परशुराम आ चुका है, सो दिस कांट बी अ घोड़ा। सो इज अ घोड़ा इज अ वेहीकल। सो डू यू थिंक दैट कालकी इज गोइंग टू कम अटैच्ड विद अ वेहीकल एंड देयरफॉर ही सेड इज कालकी अ टीटी coming from somewhere else, so spaceship is already included. And that's possible. The other interpretation was that आज भी हम मोटर गाड़ी की स्पीड को या उसकी पावर को हॉर्स पावर बोलते हैं। So do you think that this Kalki is a half human and half non-human who is actually energized externally? So the ghoda is a metaphor, basically saying that Kalki is actually not a 100% organic human being. So we went on discussing what is possible, what is not possible. Again, future, अटकले लगा सकते हैं। जो आप कह रहे हैं possible है।
कल की revelation के लिए आएंगे या जो thought का process है या destroying continuity पे जाओ।
I will call that continuity. I'll call that continuity because that's the way, that's the direction they are going. I suppose that's what I will say.
Yes, please. We are a little sort of getting towards the end, so we'll make that round to the second last.
See, what happens is these days when I reach home a little late at times. Earlier I used to go home, but now I feel that I'm not going home, I'm going to some parking lot. There are cars and cars parked on either side of the road. And actually it doesn't look like I'm going to a home. There was a time when I actually used to go home. So what I feel is that the time will come when we will not design cities, we will design smart parking lots. We will be living in huge parking lots like my house, pillar number 77. So I no more. See, the thing is, earlier the living was the prime motive of designing cities. But now, commuting has taken over. We commute we communicate. These two things are what we are going to revolve around. That is the evolution, basically. So, is it not time that we think of either? Now, as you said, continuity, you talk about discontinuity, and then we talk about reversal also, while talking about the terraces and things like that. So, there are only two ways. Either we think of reversals, or we accept the continuity and proceed further and look at it from that angle that yes, commuting is the primary thing, whether you park your cars, whether you are living in parking lots. I designed a beautiful parking lot that my address is parking lot North 32B. That is my address. And a beautiful parking lot has a place also where people are living.
Multi-story parking.
Whatever.
You're absolutely right. I mean,
but we have to commute. That is what the efficiency in commuting is required.
I have a difference in opinion in that, because I think that I feel that you are only limiting parking to a car. I go home to park myself.
Yes, it is. It is actually.
I use the car to reach that parking lot of me. So the car also has to be parked, but then I climb up the steps and I park myself. And I park for the night. And next day morning, I move out from the parking lot to do my work.
Yes.
Right. Now, the point is that if I look at that Katal Yuk, if I go back to original old village, rural, vernacular houses, they are one room sets. They don't have a three-bedroom drawing dining with three toilets, attached. So, whole day, the human being was outside under the open sky with the Mother Earth. At night, right from whatever 10,000 years or even 1 million years, they parked themselves inside a room. The room was actually a storehouse. Now today, we are back to that same square. I think it just went round and round in circles. We think it is three bedroom. We basically are parking ourselves there. I mean, today, it has happened. What was there, say 20,000 years ago? So I don't know if we changed. I think it's still the same. I mean, that's the way I interpret it.
To direct one last question.
Okay,
that's good. Thank you very much. I think it was a kind of exciting session. Now, the whole range of issues being talked about, debated, it just shows the kind of involvement that we have in cities and maybe in the future, because I think Tapan was refusing to go into the future for very valid reasons of his. And his philosophies, and there are other people who just want to think in the future. So, and there are some people who want to think in the past. So I think this range of issues that we discussed and the questions that emerged were very exciting. Thank you very much to the organizers.